Before that, the Channel 4 racing teams, trackside at Newmarket.
Welcome to the Morning Line, another hour of racing's news and reviews about to get underway. And if you're sitting at home thinking, God, I wouldn't mind a job like his, sat out in the sunshine chatting about racing, well, I can assure you there's a little bit of a doddle money for old rope. But on the other hand, if you see a job down the job centre advertised for a racing commentator, well, unless you think you can match this, stay at home.
Light blue cap Ruby, red colours green Crusader, Tony Eyes going to work. On the extreme right, the pale blue Walsh and Whisper. And Chabanaz and the black and white star jacket trying to come with a run, but it's still Connick Hill that has the edge. Here goes Walsh and Whisper on the outside. The dark blue cap green Crusader getting closer. Chabanaz getting serious, and now it's a rush to the line. It's still Connick Hill who just has it from green Crusader, and it's going to be a desperate four-way photo at the line. Oh, very close indeed. Whoa, Chabanaz, Connick Hill, Green Crusader, Walsh and Whisper, Blue Blazer, Icus Girl, and last of all was Ruby.
Well, that's how to call them home. 1, 2, 3, flash past. Chabanaz just gets up right in the dying stride to beat Connick Hill and Green Crusader. And, well, the man who did it, Graham Good. Were you really confident? I mean, sometimes you say, oh boy, that's close. That's one of your favourites. Or I'll leave that, or I'll leave that to the
judge.
Leave that to the judge. But that was as close as I've ever seen.
Yes. But hopefully, all things being equal, here at Newmarket in a good position, you're high up and you're on the line.
But is it easy? I mean, Chabanaz came really fast in late
there. Yes, between the two. And also, just either a stride after the line, Stephen Davis started to go, ooh, you know, as if he's, well, that'll do for me. And, yes.
But
That's the view from the commentary box. It's we're all right here.
Yeah.
July course at Newmarket, we're all right.
I can remember there were only two horse involved in a photo finish at Chester one day, and I nailed my sails to the mast and said I'd cut all the grass in the paddock with nail scissors if one hadn't won, and of course
it
hadn't.
If you want to know the time, ask a policeman.
Yes, that's about right. John, how would you have coped with that? I can remember you at Chester one day when you looked out the commentary box, 24 runners for the Chester Cup, and said, where are they? Never mind. Never mind what's won. And I think they just galloped by at the time.
I do have trouble with the boat race.
It was either Oxford or Cambridge, one of them.
But, it is a real skill. Mac, did you ever fancy a hand at that?
Oh, well, I've done it once. I'm in absolute shambles. I don't even talk about that, the skill of it.
But
the extraordinary thing is here that at Newmarket, they've got the Mitsubishi Diamond screen, and the punters could see the finish. The bookmakers are listening on their dogs to GG's commentary, and they also knew that Chabanaz, because of what you said, had got it, and they went 5-1 against Connick Hill, although it was a 16-1 chance, the complete outsider of the whole lot. The bookmakers wanted it to win. They knew that Chabanaz, thanks to GG, that Chabanaz had won it.
Well, what I always dread is your microphone going down. That did happen once at I think it was at Fakenham in the ITV days. An amateur rider's hurdle with about 25 runners, and Bruff was doing the paddock, and he'd sort of swatted up the two favourites.
Yes, which is one more than us.
They were the only two he knew anything about. Gigi's mic went down going to the first hurdle, and Bruff had a foggy monitor.
He made
a wonderful job, but it was a two-horse race.
Right, yeah. I'll tell you, we've been blowing your trumpet, but I'll tell you who's done really well. Well, there's Derek Thompson. I mean, he's only started.
Yes.
I think, you know, he's done. I mean, because it's not an easy job. Anyway, enough of blowing our own trumpets here, and blowing Graham and Derek's. Anyway, let's get you up to date with what's going on around the country. 7 meetings, apart from, of course, the meeting here at headquarters. There's only one jump fixture, but the other flat racing is going on at Haydock, at Redcar, at Ayr this evening, at Wolverhampton, and Lingfield. And as I said, that jump fixture also at Worcester.
Well, last week, Lester Piggott dominated the headlines. He's doing it again. In The Independent, the return of a legend provides an oasis of interest at Newmarket, but Swedish racegoers are deserted. He's not going over to Sweden tomorrow. Piggott ready for action. Picked up in The Sporting Life, Piggott ready for TV return. and in the Star, it says silence of the critics. Well, it's not silence of the critics, it's like the George Foreman syndrome, isn't it? Coming back to fight for the world title at 45. It's a bit of a sad charade that's going on, but we're all part of it. And I know most of you don't agree with me, because this letter I received, an anonymous letter was sent to me this week, one of many, I must hasten to add. You have recently said that Leicester should retire, but he's not the first jockey to fall from a horse. And my question is, when are you going to retire? We are not taking votes on that. Picked up in the Sporting Life, the RSPCA are targeting H9. That's the whip rule, which says that the jockey club is being pressed to radically rewrite the whip guidelines so that a horse is disqualified if the jockey breaks the rules. That would stop excessive use of the whip. I wish they'd bring it in. No sign that the jockey club will. Other problems for the jockey club occurred at Redcar. Withdrawals leave punters all at sea yesterday. Media Express and Yard Dancer were left in the stalls. Punters didn't get a run for the money under starters' orders. When Johnny Weatherby left the jockey club, the spine went out of them on this issue, and punters have been turned over day in, day out, because the jockey club won't make sure that horses race, or they don't race, you get your money back. But good news at Southall, the Jimmy Tarbuck had his first winner there. He has a share in Casper's Wrist, trained by Jeff Lewis, that won the seller. So Jimmy Tarbuck, a winner at last. Tips for today, well, in the 420, Belfry Green, that's quite popular, a lot of hacks. And Templegate Super Six, remember he gave six for the Stewards' Cup, none won. Let's see if we do any better this week. Belfry Green, Face North, Dime Time, My Best Valentine, KV and Everglades. Some are suggesting the six horses to leave out, but we'll see how the race goes. Cezanne, that's in the Super Mirror, by far the best of the supplements. The Mirror, they go for Cezanne, that's in the 3 o'clock at Haydock. But they picked in that race is Glatisson by Mark Winstanley in the Life, and he says, Jeff Rags filly has suffered more bad luck than a pork pie salesman in Palestine this season, but my mole in the yard assures me she has never been better. And she was very well back before the Nassau Stakes, which she didn't run in last Saturday. The Times, it takes the big race of the whole weekend, is the Heinz 57 Phoenix Stakes at Leopardstown tomorrow, General Menashe to take command. In the Mail, Mind Games to master General Menashe again. Jack Berry can lift his first Group 1. How popular that would be. In the Today, jolly good fallow so unlucky at Goodwood. And finally, a bit sort of sad, I think, that Manhattan Boy, who's won 14 sellers all at Plumpton. He's up for sale with a share of him, but he will stay with John Fitch-Hayes, the good old 12-year-old. And also for sale, the Laughing Lord. My noble lord, I think you'll be bidding at Doncaster for the Laughing Lord. There you are. Or are you for sale yourself?
Yes, I'm afraid. I'm like you.
Cut rate, right,
no,
I'm afraid.
Like you,
lord.
No bidders.
They'd knock you down.
Poor old chicky can't give him away at the moment. Right. If you're coming racing here at the July course this afternoon, then you won't be needing a Macintosh, or you won't be needing anything really warm, because really another sunny afternoon in prospect. The going is good on the straight course, good to firm, just the last furlong and a half, and it's been an amazing success this Friday and Friday evening, Saturday afternoon fixtures that they've been having here at Newmarket. Only two meetings left here on the July course, unfortunately, and the sooner they get more evening fixtures, the better. They've been averaging 13,000 and the crowds here. Look out for the roadworks, though, on the A11, on the four Wentways, and just do leave a little bit of extra time. Good racing in prospect. We get underway at 3:15. Our big race, of course, is the 4:15. It's the Brierley Investments Handicap. Let's have a look at the best prices for that race. There's 23, almost £24,000 going to the winner of this race. And Face North, the winner of the Hunt Cup and the Victoria Cup. Well, Seb Sanders mount, a 6-to-1 shot there. Dime Tom, the improving colt there of John Gosden's. That's an 8-to-1 shot. Belfry Green, he's coming back to his best in the distance. Wendell Woods, 9-to-1. And then Lester Piggott returns this afternoon, as Mac was telling you, on Onotondant. And he was a winner of this race last year.
It's Face North that takes it up now. Face North Indian Slave with Coral's Dream. Caspon coming there very strongly indeed on the outside of Norfolk Hero. Blockade has done his running. Green Cap went off the rail is Young Earn, but they've got just over a furlong to go. On Attendant starts a dash to the line, and it's on Attendant on the outside of Caspon. These go on from Face North. Young Earn the rails. On Attendant veering right over to the rails, and he's swishing his tail, but it's gone too clear. He's picked the race by the scruff of the neck and driving to the line. On Attendant takes it from Indian Slave in second.
So, question is, £30 worth terms this year. facing horse meeting on the time. Is he going to be good enough? He's obviously a horse in form.
Yeah, well, for you, Lord.
No, sorry. You face north is on the crest of a wave, but this track and distance does seem to suit Onaton. He's never been beaten over this 7 furlongs, won this race the last 2 years, so you have to take that into account. But face north, having won the Hunt Cup and then run a blinder at Goodwood.
He's a smashing, and he's only a tiny little horse, but you know, he's just got that extra bit of weight this afternoon. As John says, Onaton runs well here.
Yeah, well, he started winning off 73, didn't he? He's now off 95, and okay, Seb Sanders takes a £5 allowance off, but I would have thought the horse to go up £22, if he wins today or runs prominently today, the handicapper could very well be jumping off the stands.
Yeah.
I think he's got his full share of weight, despite the fact he's a progressive horse.
And both only 6-year-olds. Sometimes you say, oh, well, one's 3 to 4 and one's probably more improved than the other. But, I mean, they're both 6-year-olds. How about Dine Time?
He won the other day very well indeed.
Picked up a race at Sandown and he's managed to weave his way through the field and come with a great run.
But he's an improvement horse. I didn't think he had the best of runs at Sandown, and he's also been given him a break. I look at when you get some of these big trainers that, you know, give horses a break, they obviously think there's a lot better to come, sort of waiting for an end of term campaign.
We can see that Sandown race, can't we?
Yeah, let's have a look at that because he does really well to get through.
Well,
let's have a look at the Bunbury Cup first, because quite a few of these runners, in actual fact, took part, of course, Onaton won it. But Celestial Key, well, he was the problem horse right there in the centre with Paul Eddery. Belfry Green, well, absolutely gets murdered against the rails. Let's just run that through now and have a look at it. Onaton, on the other hand, comes through, doesn't have too many problems with Al Piggott. And the Queen's horse there set the fashion. Runs on. Oh, I mean, that Belfry Green did particularly well to stay on his feet there. Onaton, we saw him when he won this race last year. Doesn't love to, but he does hang left-handed.
And what also in the race is Tarafwid, which we weren't able to highlight there. He was on the outside and really finished really well. But Belfry Green would probably very nearly have won that race.
Drawn 12 this afternoon, no Onaton. What do you think?
Yes, and remember that in the race last year, he comes from off the pace, and he hung left last year, he got the run of the rail last year. Yeah. Anything on the inside of him, just makes him difficult.
And Belfry Green ran at Ascot last time, over a mile. Slowish run race. But
yeah, but just goes to show you, I mean, there was a huge field here at Newmarket and the horse got into trouble. Only 7 runners in Ascot, he still got into a little bit of trouble.
Yeah, he seems to get himself into trouble. I mean, but I think
he's a good horse. I mean, I must admit, I thought that he'd win at Ascot. It was a mile, and I thought, well, I know that he'll fairly certainly get the trip, and it looked as though he didn't. I mean, 7 is his trip, and if he gets the run in the race, he was desperately unlucky not to take a closer hand in the end of this.
Yeah, but this race is like a big bowl of spaghetti, isn't it? You sort of pick one little bit of spaghetti out, and by the time you found your way to the bottom. Well, I mean, the form lines are so interwoven and so very, very, very difficult.
From a man who likes his food, a good analogy, I'd say. Let's have a look at Dime Time anyway, because this one's obviously you've got a chance. And
the thing about this race is that Balashak on the front end there, he'd made the running. And this horse races rather freely. Now, apprentice Tony Whelan, who's moved over from Richard Hannon to Jeff Lewis, might have his hands full today. The horse might run a bit freely, could be suited by the track. Meantime, here goes Dime Time, green and white hoops. All of a sudden, it's all over by the shouting, and the horse storms 3 or 4 clear. Balashak stays on gamely for second place, but Pat and Paul couldn't win on the horse today. £7 claimer rides this afternoon. Very impressive run by Dime Time, but Balashak would have chances, I thought. There's one horse in the race that we must give a mention to, and that's the Richard Wasps. No, it isn't. And that's the horse called L-Shape, drawn one. Improved for going to Mary Reevely, and I can see him being up with the pace and that run of the rail.
But he ran well when he was with Dandy Nichols, but for some reason just taken on a new lease of life. I mean, running 7 furlong races, in 3 or 4 lengths with his head in his chest.
But there have been claimers, haven't there? I mean, he's had 2 real morale boosters his last 2 runs. Yes. In claiming races, this has got to be a bit more difficult.
Yeah, but I mean the horse as a 2-year-old, it was 3rd at Ascot, wasn't it? I mean, it's a fair performer. On his day.
Quick question, excuse me, no extras. What do you think about this one, Gary Moore's horse? I mean, very consistent, due a chance, still running on the same sort of handicap mark.
It's typical of how open the race is, because no extras has run against about 5 of them and never finished more than about a yard behind them.
Beat Everglades and company at Lingfield, didn't he? Yeah, not a very good win-to-run ratio, though, not like on the track.
Yeah, OK, tips?
At the price, possibly L-shaped, a little bit each way.
I'm afraid I'd have to go for you. How about you, John?
Face north.
Face north and a couple for owl shapes. And, well, I wouldn't mind a little bit on KV either. I think the race will be set up for him. But if you're going racing this afternoon, then it's fairly much the same as it has been for the last few days. It's going to be dry and it's going to be sunny. Yeah, pictures there from headquarters. Just a little bit cloudy at the moment. Horses just going back in from second lot, that would be now. Pull out really early here. But as those horses will be making their way back to their breakfast, let's get some news from the other meetings.
Head up, tremendous race there, as we've been telling you, for the Glatizon trying for a third time lucky, and Royal Ballerina trying to produce the form which got her second in Two Oaks last year. No reported hazards on the roads. They've had a little bit of rain up there and the going is good.
Well, meanwhile at Redcar, Mary Reevely has saddled twice as many winners over the past 3.5 years as anybody else. Willie Ryan is the leading jockey on the track, and the two team together with Parliament Peace. They should conjure up a good run in the Paul Daniels handicap. Racing at Redcar is at 2:15. It starts, the going is good to firm in the back straight, good in the home straight. It's been dry overnight, no reported hazards on the road. Make your way to sunny Redcar.
And they start at 2:35 at Ayr, where it's good to soft. Plenty of rain up there. And Jason Weaver, don't forget, he is second in the jockey's table. He may be 25 behind Frankie Dettori, but Frankie's going abroad. Who knows? Jason riding at Ayr.
And Jason goes to Wolverhampton for one ride in the last race there. He's the leading jockey at Wolverhampton, where racing starts at 6 o'clock. The going is standard, isn't it always just? And there are no reported hazards on the road. End of a long week for all the jockeys at Wolverhampton.
And at Lingfield, the first race is at 5:50. They're racing on both the turf and the all-weather. And ladies, kindly dress up to your best, because there's competitions for old ladies, young ladies and small ladies. Three prizes for the best dressed. My director asked whether there's a prize for fat ladies. I'm sure there will be plenty of drinks for them anyway. Oh, watch out for those roadworks on the M25, Junction 5 and between Junction 7 and 8.
Chapter and verse on Worcester. Well, jockey Philip and trainer Peter Hobbs are the team to look out for, and they're the leading trainer and jockey at Worcester's, certainly as far as the punters are concerned. They team up with Greenback when one of the maiden hurdle races there, where the first race at Worcester is at 6:10. No reported hazards in getting there. The going is good to firm. It's the coming back that worries you.
Right, well, we got Big Mac with some betting news. What are you going to give us the betting on, Mac?
Well, I think you remember this time last week I was saying Glatizon was attracting earlier money at 14-1 and less for the Nassau Stakes. Well, it's in here at the 3 o'clock at Haydock. Money again for it. 10-1's going. They're taking the 8-1, so certain to expecting a big run from Glatizon. Looks well in at the weights there. In the 4:20 at Newmarket, very wide open betting, but very early moves. 3 Everglades and 17-4 were ran at 14-16-1. Some money for them, but wide open betting. Nothing spectacular in the market. But the key race for many of you must be the 4:50 here. Now, a maiden. How often is the last race on Channel 4 on a Saturday a maiden? It's Alanese is the one for Clive Britton. Now, it's not run this season, as you know. I've just spoken to Clive. He said the horse, why he hasn't run it, injured a knee just before going for the free handicap. Clive reckons it really is back, expects a very big run from it, and provided it wins today, which he expects, it goes for the Hungerford Stakes, a Group 3 race at Newbury next weekend. So Alanese, the banker for so many of you, the trainer expects it to run a really big race. It's fit, it's well, and it's definitely different class. Only 6.5 lengths behind Grand Lodge in the Dewhurst, and around the 2-1 chance. If you can beat it around 2-1 Alanese, it could well be short. If confidence grows in Alanese, it looks to be the only horse, and it's the last on Channel 4. Why haven't bookies made that a handicap? They don't like those maidens, you know.
Really is a punter's friend, Matt. That was the first thing he said when he came in this morning. Must ring Clive Britton up and find out about Alan E. So let's hope that that one runs well. Another to look out for in that race is Elfland. And later on in this programme, we'll be showing you having his last run. Also coming up is Horse Box. Of course, we'll be looking at last weekend's Group 2 race in Deauville, the Prix Maurice de Geest. And, well, we're going to go into a break now with the turf trivia. And the question is, which track did Lester Piggott ride his first winner on? Which track did Lester Piggott ride his first winner on? And that's not a railway track.
Which paper takes you closer to the top names in racing? What paper has unique facts and figures for all the day's meetings? Who gives you the full rundown on past performances for every horse?
Morning, Racing Post. It's all in there today.
The Racing Post is designed for you. It's got all you need for racing today. The Racing Post. Everyone's reading it. Are you?
Renault 19 and Clio Beba. Beba. From £6,666.
Mama. When you hear a child crying, you can often make everything better with a cuddle.
But it's harder to reach out to children in the developing world who are so far away.
Actually, there is one way you can reach out to them, through child sponsorship.
It's a way of providing the basic essentials so many third world children lack.
Like clean water.
And nourishing food.
Proper health care.
Clean, safe homes.
You can help provide all these necessities for third world families and communities by sponsoring a child through Plan International. I think it's a wonderful way to help whole communities.
And help people in the third world to help themselves.
If you're interested in sponsoring a child and would like to find out more, call Plan International free on 0800 100 160. The call won't cost you anything, and you could make all the difference to a child's life. 0800 100 160.
You think your brickwork's safe as houses? Well, you're wrong. Water's attacking it right now. Stop it with Thompson's Water Seal. It's this easy. It forms a waterproof barrier so rain can't damage your bricks. Spend a few quid on Thompson's or a few hundred on repairs. It's up to you.
Thompson's Water Seal. Buy now. Don't pay later.
I don't care what the weatherman says. When the weatherman says it's raining, you'll never hear me complaining. I'm certain sunshine. I don't care how the weather...
There is a new antiperspirant, Sure-Sensive with aloe vera.
It's got to be sunny to me.
It's tough on perspiration, but also gentle on the skin. Gentleness in a tough world.
Oh, gee, but
new Sure-Sensive.
The feature-packed Clio and 19 Bebop from just £6,666. Visit your Renault dealer today.
So they... Did you get it? Wasn't too difficult for the first trivia of the morning. On which track did Lester Piggott ride his first winner? And of course it was Haydock Park, and the horse, fairly ironically, was called The Chase, considering he's gone on to be the greatest flat jockey ever. That was in 1948, 18th of August. Well, Haydock Park was the place where he rode his first winner. Haydock Park, well, they've got racing there this afternoon, and their big race is the Burton Wood Brewery Rose of Lancaster Stakes. It's a Group 3 race, £22,000 going to the winner, and Cezanne, horse of Godolphin Racing, who of course was trained by Hillel Ibrahim, who's now gone over to Michael Stouts, where of course he was trained formerly, ridden by Gavin Hind. He's a 7-2 joint favourite with the younger horse that Willie Carson rides, Le Hook, of course, with John Dunlop. There's a three-year-old Royal Ballerina, second in last year's Oaks. She's an 8-1 chopped, and Michael Kauntz with two runners in this race, Urgent Request, who bolted up in that race at Epsom, Richard Quinn, a 10-1 shot with Galatis Ant, but it's Cezanne and Gary Hine, joint favourites, taking their first step into group company, and they look to be certainly worthy of that shot when they came from a long way behind to take last month's John Smith Magnet Cup.
And they come past the two marker, and Midnight Legend finds reserves. Here comes Cezanne in the blue colours with a strong run. Fieldbridge back in third, Lure Water guides way. Mr. Confusion and Duke of Ureling gap wide. But it's Cezanne who's come to press the favourite Midnight Legend. And Cezanne comes to take the race. Midnight Legend is finding more. Cezanne's going to take a curve. Cezanne, Midnight Legend, Mr. Confusion. Cezanne wins it.
What do you think? Nailed on this afternoon.
Do you think so?
Absolutely nailed on. That came from nowhere to win that race.
Yeah, competitive handicap, I know, but he's stepping up in grade, I think. I mean, I'd have a pound, Le Hook over Cezanne, wherever they finish.
Absolutely.
Right.
I don't like taking your money off you. He's just that is a lovely looking horse.
You could say it looks a picture, couldn't
one,
you?
Yes, I would have done, but I mean, I'll leave those to you.
Thank you.
Come on now, come on. You can't say he's nailed on. First of all, we simply don't know how good Gatizon is. She's had no chance in her last two runs. Royal Ballerina's got two ways of running, and the good way is very, very close to classic form.
Well, the thing we do know about Glatison is if she's got to come out of the stalls first. Now, let's have a look what happened in the Falmouth Stakes. Just remind yourselves of this. This was back in early July. Pat Edry on board. The stall handler doing a tremendous job to keep hold of her. Pat injured his ankle, unfortunately. That really wasn't her fault, I didn't think. She got a little bit upset, and as I said, the stall handler did a smashing job. And then 10 days later, back here at headquarters, she had to go along and undergo a stalls test just to show that she was perfectly capable. Brother Paul deputised on this occasion, and you can see for yourself, she stood in there quite nicely with a hood on. Hood comes off, stalls open, and out she pops, no trouble at all. And then blow me down if... they haven't just got that little problem sorted out. Then she went to Goodwood, got all the way down there, and her bridle broke and was unable to take part. She's been an unlucky filly. Obviously got plenty of ability from her runs last year. But Cezanne, the form of that Magnet Cup's worked out so well. Midnight Legend's gone on and won a good handicap at Goodwood, back to his trip of a mile and a half, admittedly. But I thought he won with his ears pricked, Cezanne. He came from miles behind.
Absolutely, wouldn't disagree with you at all. But I think this is
right,
step up in class.
Even Chabanas, the horse you called out, it wasn't in the same county.
No, true.
Him. Right, come on, what's going to beat him?
Le Hook. The horse is progressive. It's a horse that's running both the Prince and the Princess of Wales. It takes major chance. The Newbury run last time was good. I think they've got a major, major chance at 7-2, 4-1-ish, Le Hook. Mm.
And two others that are not certain to be easy to beat. Urgent Request, as you say, trotted up at Epsom, then got all hyped up in the King George and
I think Le Hook is still a mile and a half horse, but let's go and have a look at Urgent Request, because he bolted up in this race at Epsom.
Yes, I mean, the second horse home here is a horse called Not In Doubt, but look at the difference in performance between this horse, who was gambled on in the morning of the race, Urgent Request, went out, made all the running, stepped up in class last time, of course, behind King's Theatre, just couldn't live with that performance. But this is Urgent Request, a good handicapper at his best, and coming home on his local track and in some style to land a major putt. That was when he won at Epsom, a long way clear of Not In Doubt.
Thing about him, you've got to remember, that was his first run of the season, and I know he's only a five-year-old and whatever, he always runs well first time up. He was then given a break, got ready for the King George. I think it was the owner that wanted to run, not Reg Akerst. And this has come quite quickly after that race at Ascot. And I'm not sure whether his horse is a big, lean thing. I'm not sure whether his horse is going to take... I mean, Reg said himself, you know, he takes no getting ready. And I'm not sure he's a horse who's going to take two races this close together.
He boiled over badly at Ascot. I mean, Reg says everything went wrong, could go wrong, you know. It's true that may have left a mark on him, but you can't... That running can be ignored completely.
Mm. One quick couple of others. We mentioned Glatison. Do you think she's good enough?
Well, you just don't know. Yeah, possibly is the answer, but I'm not good enough to beat Le Hook anyway.
And how about Tatami? because I mean, he was a good horse last year. He was running all right when Lucas were running badly, and they're just coming back into form now. He's certainly one you couldn't discount.
But one you certainly can't discount on her best form is Royal Ballerina. I know she hasn't really done it. Well, she won two little races this year. But last year, she had two ways of running last year.
Yeah.
And the good one was very good.
Yeah.
The thing about her running at Lingfield in that Daily Mail race, it was heavy ground, wasn't it?
She's got to have a cut in the ground. Mm. Yeah. Mm. Yeah, she'd give a nice lead to Suzanne anyway. Well, I'm going for Suzanne. Tip from you.
Well, Luhuk.
Oh, right, okay.
Well, Glatizon. All
right.
You're going for Glatizon, right,
tossing
okay.
Tossing the coin in the air.
Okay, you stick for the filly. Right. Last Saturday's championship.
Yes, now last Saturday the racing went on so late that we weren't able to get the result of the champion tipsters competition. So now your claims are required if you were clever enough to get 100 points or more last Saturday. That's the number to ring on, 071-757-7010.
Now, this champion tipster competition really has taken off, but if you're not quite sure what to do, let's just run through the rules for you once again. Three selections per race. Today's races are the ones televised live here at Newmarket, the 3:15, 3:45, 4:20 and 4:50. Points are accordingly scored and according to SP. The highest aggregate total wins £500. You know the number as well as I do, so say it with me, please. 0891 99 11 48. All together now, 0891 99 11 48.
Well, you've spoilt my tune. I can't say my number now. But the star prize is a British Midland holiday weekend for two and 1 year's membership for two at Uttoxeter Races. And you can go to any destination you choose between Amsterdam, Brussels, Dublin and Frankfurt, Nice, Parma, Paris, hotel, bed and breakfast. Right, now another vital competition, the picture puzzle. This is last week's picture puzzle. Thick as thieves was the answer. We didn't give you the answer last week, again, because things got late. Thick as thieves. Did you get it? Those who did, Stuart McLeod of Bristol, Dennis Atherley of Seeley Avenue, Nottingham, and Reginald Needs of Southend-on-Sea.
Well, £100 going to the winners of those, but I wonder where that saying comes from, thick as thieves. Where do you think that comes from?
I have no idea.
They stick together. The thieves don't tell on thieves. And they stick together, thick like that,
Oh, I thought it was the ones that got caught, I was thinking. Right.
You're sitting here, aren't you?
Oh, well played, Oaksey. What have you nicked out of the papers this morning, Matt?
Well, I'm just saying we never used to sneak on our chums at Harrow, so I don't know about Etonians, but we'll leave them to them. Now, the great argument that's going on in racing, should we next year, June and July, have jump racing? And it's going to be at six tracks, Market Raspberry, Perth, Southall, Stratford, Worcester and Uttoxeter. But the advocates of the change really had a blow this week on Wednesday when Exeter was highlighted in the ground warning. They ran one race there, Richard Dunwoody won it, but hard ground. Lovely course, Exeter really improving, but they cannot race on hard ground. Very quick word, lads. Jump racing June and July.
Diabolical. Don't know why they ever thought about it.
Well, it's not such a bad idea because you've got grass growing this time of year, June and July. Now, August and September, different kettle of fish altogether with a dry summer.
Don't take Devon and Exeter as an example. There's no watering at Devon and Exeter. They won't be racing at Devon. At least they mustn't race at Devon and Exeter in midsummer. The tracks they have chosen can water, but will they water enough? That's the point. This period next year will be a trial, and if they don't water enough and there's hard ground, it all ought to be scrapped.
They've watered at Worcester this evening, and there was one race, they didn't get one single entry. Where are the runners going to come from?
I think it's a very fair point. Will the trainers run the horses? Will the public go for them? And Peter Chappell Higham in the Racing Post, he has his say. He says that, in my opinion, we have too much racing in this country already, and they would be better off trying to improve what we've got rather than increasing the programme and lowering standards still further. I'll remain neutral on that, but I won't remain neutral on telephone tipsters. The number of letters I get complaining about the tipsters, the papers, especially the trade papers, are very ambivalent about it because they get a lot of money from it, but David Ashforth really cracks into them in a superb piece today in The Sporting Life. And he actually says what he thinks about them. He says, with honourable exceptions, tipping services have nothing to do with satisfying punters' needs and everything to do with satisfying tipsters' greeds. And that about sums it up. Anyone who knows the winners, they don't have to give phone line services, etc. And this is David Ashworth. He went to four tipsters, and the absolute murder that he had, the services he contacted, cost about £8, he said, had nothing worthwhile to offer in the way of analysis, and took several minutes to convey what could have been said in less than one. It was like being forced to listen to the ramblings of a betting shop bore. Don't go for telephone tipsters. If they knew the winners, as I said, they're back on themselves. In the Daily Express, a lovely piece here, Declan Murphy back with Joe Park, two-page spread, and it tells some of the suffering that he went through, that terrible accident at Haydock in May. He says he uses it to demonstrate how surgeons fished for the blood clot and removed it. Then he explains how they replaced the top of his skull, sewing it on so that all remains now is a soft groove like that in the skull of a newborn baby, which should be close up in a couple of months. Joe mercifully intervenes. Absolutely terrific. Welcome back, Declan. If you want to know what's happening to Hackney Dogs and the new track they built, their great big story here in the Independent Merit magazine. Very sad. The great dreams for Hackney seem to be dying. And if you think about betting, well, who'd better tell you about money than the Financial Times? And Michael Thompson Noel has this to say about gambling. He says, the gambling urge is ancient, universal and ingrained. Internationally, the gambling business is growing frantically. You cannot extinguish gambling, so you might as well regulate it and allow it to develop in a civilized manner, as free of shysterism or criminal influence as, banking or insurance or financial services. Absolutely well done. That's the thing. Gambling, well controlled, as we've got it in this country, is unparalleled around the world. Great news, of course, in the Times and all papers, the Test match. England strengthen their grip. Let's hope we can get one all back in the series. Magnificent batting and bowling by our lads yesterday. And with taxi drivers, I don't know how any taxi driver ever finds time to drive his cab. They all know about racing so much, but they've got a very bad image. And this is picked up here in the Daily Mail weekend by Alice Fowler. And she said that she went on a trip in London. My fare comes to £2.60. In the confusion, I hand over a £10 note and walk away as though I think I've paid £5. With a loud mouth to contend with, my cabbie has every reason not to notice. But suddenly he is tooting and shouting, calling me back. This is a £10 note, he explains, pointing to the figures on the corner. You have to be very careful or you'll lose your lot of money. He counts into my hand the 7.40 change. And I've always found cabbies absolutely terrifically honest and a really good story in their favour. Quite right, too. And finally, in the sporting life, the lifestyles of Willie Muir, the trainer, and quite rightly, he has his pet hate here. He says his pet hate being called Bill, especially by the Channel 4 team, who continue to put on the screen whenever I have a runner, trained by Bill Muir. I can tell you one thing, Willie, we won't do it again.
Oh, I wouldn't hold your breath over that. I think you're going to be Bill for a long time to come.
Well, No.
Having a really good time at the moment. Willie Muir, of course, who trained Chabanas, horses running out of their skins. Well, the wonderful season of racing at Deauville's now well underway. Last Sunday saw their Group 2 race, the 6.5 furlong sprint, the Morris de Geest, and it brought together, well, Unblessed in Owenton, of course, who won our July Cup, and they had a cracking lineup for this race down there. And, at the end of it, Gigi's going to do it live, this commentary, so professional, but it was the four-year-olds who held the day.
Well,
we got nothing.
Nothing to look at the moment. We're just waiting for the race to come up.
Go on,
make it up, indeed. Why not? So it's Catrail in the lead. That's the one with the white sleeve jacket. Further left, as we look at them, Spain Lane under Walter Swinburne. Darkish colours, one off the rail is Lavinia Fontana. Westman runs the rail, the blinkered runner. In behind them, looking for room, is Unblessed. Dolphin Street on the extreme left, just to the right of my left of my elbow, is coming with a run. But it's still Catrail the leader. They've got that four orange bowls means they've got 2 furlongs to go. Still Catrail with the edge. Then comes a Spain Lane. Look at Dolphin Street coming up on the outside. Yellow Cap Erington looks for room. Unblessed has looked for room too. Hasn't found a lot, but here goes Dolphin Street. It went inside the last furlong now, and it's Dolphin Street going on. Catrail, the white sleeve jacket, starts to rail. Lavinia Fontana runs through next to the rail, but Dolphin Street is clear. But look at this, Catrail rallying as they go up towards the line. Dolphin Street and Catrail is close at the post. Dolphin Street takes it from Catrail in second, Lavinia Fontana third. Unblessed is in fourth.
Very good. Very, very impressed. Do you naturally get your enthusiasm. As soon as you see a race and you begin to start calling the horses out,
I suppose
do you have to wind yourself up?
I think you do have to wind yourself up for it. It's obviously, it's a performance. And at the end of the day, nobody ever applauds. A lot of people go, ah, the fellow got it wrong.
You missed just one,
absolutely.
Everybody remembers that
absolutely.
For months.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah. The awful thing must be that it comes back and back at you. I mean, you commentate on the Derby, that's going to be repeated 100 times, isn't
it? Yes, never mind. The do we do is an all right spy out.
I don't mind.
And now, how much homework do you have to do? I mean, there's a reasonable amount of runners here this afternoon. How did your day begin?
Funnily enough, the more important the race, in some ways, the easier the commentary. I mean, the guys who commentate around the country on a regular basis, and we've got a moment to talk about that in a moment, but I mean, you get a big maiden field at Redcar, and particularly at Windsor into the setting sun, then you really do have to go to work. The more prestigious the meeting, the better the meeting, the more familiar the owners, the more familiar the names of the horses, and you know the style that the horses are going to run to.
But I can remember asking you one day, what is the very latest? Because myself and Oaksey always turn up and, you know, if the homework's done at the last 2 minutes. Asking you about, you know, how could you cope if just you were suddenly faced with an 18-runner race and you went to Pontefract very late one day, I believe.
Well, yes, that's true. For anybody who's ever been to Pontefract, you know that there is a very, very long sort of walkway through from the bottom where the traffic lights are, all the way up to the top of the stands there. Now, I was going to Pontefract. It took me about an hour and a half to get from Doncaster to Pontefract, and the car got stuck in traffic. I had to get out. Me run about a mile, and I actually got all the way up. I can assure you, it's a very, very long way from the start of the Pontefract gates to the entrance. I had to weave my way through people. People queue up to go racing at Pontefract. Wonderful place to go. And I ran through the stands, right to the top of the stands, and actually got there as the stalls were opening. Phew.
And you called them out all right?
Yeah. It was only a 5-runner fielding.
And Matt, you want to say something?
I must say, the greatest thing that Gigi does is brought in his calling the colours in the blue cap, in the black hat, in the white sleeves. The old-fashioned commentators are called streams of horses. They think it's clever. It's not. You commentate Gigi for the telly age.
Yes. Now, we're going to have a big snag coming up in the near future is when the commentary teams of satellite information services into the betting shops and the race courses are going to be amalgamated. Financial expediency dictates that. But pity the poor commentators, because all 22 commentators are going to be professional people, are being asked to work for 30 days a year at their minimum. They can be allocated to go down to Newton Abbott. The next day they can go to Fakenham. The next day they can go to Hamilton. If that's not bad enough, they're going to be working one day in every 10 days.
Lots
of people would like to do it. But if you want to say, get the job done properly, if you want the job done properly, how can the guy relate to the pictures when he's talking to, one, the telephone premium services, two, the race course, three, the closed circuit television, four, the betting shop television?
Call the colours, as you do. It's
all very well and good calling the colours, but you're assuming that people are seeing the colours. Now, if people aren't seeing the colours,
the
you can't do
it. The pudding will be in the eating, so when people start complaining about that, but what about things that you notice during the race? You're racing every day of the week.
Yes.
I mean, last Saturday, there was a horse around here called Lab Test.
Yes.
Now, we can have a look at that. Nothing was said at the time, but it's been in the papers. Just have a look at this, because
I mean, this is the thing that all race readers, really, not just the commentators, spot when a horse. And of course, the thing about race reading nowadays is that, and unlike the commentary, is you have about 14 bites of the cherry. And I look at this horse, Lab Test, trained by Colin Williams. I had a chat with Colin at Pontefract earlier in the week, actually, and he was a little bit disappointed with the ride that this horse was given. £20,000 nursery, this is. Costs a lot to enter the horse. A little bit outpaced, and he can't go. Now, the field are bunching. He's still at the back of the pack, and the jockey's looking for room. Colin did tell me the horse came back with a slightly twisted shoe, but he's in behind a wall of horses here. Meanwhile, the winner's gone on. Lab Test still starting his run. There's a horse with a noseband. It's easy to spot, absolutely easy to spot, but the jockey, somehow or other, just doesn't seem to want to, or can't, or won't go forward. I think Colin was disappointed with the ride the horse was given, but meanwhile, the winner has flown.
But of course, a lot of race readers and a lot of spotters, what they can do, and everybody these days has videos, you can go back and check it and rerun it and rerun it and rerun it. The commentator's got one bite of the cherry.
But why? So the stewards have got just as much chance.
Absolutely.
Why wasn't that picked up? That was absolute blatant. The very worst. I don't care. You can make excuses. Say what you like. They should have at least said, what's going on there? Have you got cramp in all four limbs?
That's right. Well, absolutely. I mean, very, very...
They might just as well not have been here last Saturday.
On that particular race?
Yeah, on that particular race.
Or that particular race.
Right, anyway, that was lab test last week. Certainly one to look out for, but happier things to report, because it's John Reed's birthday today, 39 years old. He's already got 64 winners on the clock, 6 in the jockeys table last year with 108 winners, so he's well on the way to beating that. Of course, won the Derby on Dr. Davis, won the King George on Ilda Bourbon, lots of other big prizes, and happy birthday to John Reed. Still got the horse box to come, but let's go into the break with one more turf trivia, and slightly more difficult this one, because it's been sent in. Which horse finished third of four runners in a chase at Newton Abbott on the opening day of the 89-90 season and then went on to score at the Cheltenham Festival? So which horse finished third of four runners in a chase at Newton Abbott on the opening day of the 1989-90 season, then went on to win at the Cheltenham Festival? Answer in a few moments.
It's Peugeot's 10-day summer carnival. There are great deals on a great range of cars, with free insurance on most models, £300 cash back on the 306, and a chance to win a new 306 or another fantastic prize. The 10-day summer carnival at your local Peugeot dealer. Don't miss it.
This is the original Color Magic car polish from Turtle Wax, rated number one by Auto Trade magazine. It's color enriched to blend with your car's color. When you polish, minor scratches disappear, like magic. Just pick the colour closest to your car's finish and see how Colour Magic blends in to enhance the true colour and polish off those imperfections. One easy application leaves a brilliant deep gloss shine that can last up to 12 months. The original Turtle Wax Colour Magic. Seeing is believing.
Please call 0345 315 315 now to make a donation. You can help the British Red Cross save lives.
If you're about to buy a mobile phone, the way to avoid slipping up is to go to People's Phone and check out which of our 12 tariffs is cheapest for you. People's Phone, where talk is cheaper. For your nearest shop, call 0345 10 11 12.
Wait! Before you renew your car insurance, see if the AA can give you a better deal. Call free on 0800 444 777 for your free quote today.
You can go round and round in circles, or just pop round to your local sweet shop. There's more in store at Spa. Miles nearer, smiles better.
As you decide where to secure your savings for the future, consider entrusting it with NPI, because NPI are already looking after £7 billion and specialise in one thing. As time goes by, you'll be glad you chose NPI.
Sorry.
Time for a sharp exit. Time for a cool, sharp harp.
So there you go. Did you get it? Which horse finished third of four runners on the opening day of the jump season, then went on to win at the Cheltenham Festival? Well, it was New Halen, and that one was sent in by Paul Davis, who lives in Leicester. Well, there's no non-runners to report so far in today, so let's crack on with the horse box. And this morning, well, we've got Richard Goddard, and his complaint is the fact that too many jockeys don't ride horses out for the smaller places.
More must be done about jockeys who are not riding their mounts out to gain the best possible positions. Nowadays, a lot of bets revolve around minor place betting, place pots, tri-cast, forecast. A lot of top jockeys tend to drop their hands once the winning chance has gone and coast in. Once the stewards are quick enough to punish jockeys that do their best in finishes for misuse of the whip. But all too often, top jockeys are allowed to get away with not riding their horses out in finishes. I feel that these jockeys are not only cheating the form, they're cheating the punters. John.
What do you think we can do about it? It's been going on for years, this. It's one of those things, I must admit, even when I was riding, I was guilty of it. And it's very difficult. I mean, I make an excuse jumping. If you've been riding, and John will back me up, I'm sure here, if you've been riding a horse 2 miles, the ground's heavy, and it's given everything, and all you've done to is trying to ride it to win, and then you suddenly think, oh, well, it's not going to win. Your legs are aching, the horse is knackered.
The horse is knackered.
And I totally agree with you, it's wrong. There is absolutely no excuse for it at all. Every horse should be ridden out. But what's the answer?
Well, the answer must be the stewards. Jockeys, some of them should join equity. They've dropped their hands. They've dropped their hands more times than Frank Bruno. People in betting shops, they evaluate the form. John, often you've said about each-way thieves. Then you find out you've got a bigger thief riding the horse.
And nothing is more infuriating upon us. The number of letters we get in, the complaints we get in. You are speaking for so many punters. But I would like to see the stewards really punishing a jockey. This is even what they're saying, they go back to the old argument, for not trying to win, they get £400, £700 fines. In Hong Kong, it was 9 months. Now, the jockeys hate me for saying this, but if jockeys were punished, now, if that ride we saw there just a few moments ago, if that was punished, he wouldn't do it again.
But we're talking about a totally different thing. There's 9 months and what...
No, I'm not saying 9 months for not placed.
No, I know.
Severe punishment.
Richard. Yes.
Well, one thing to do is prize money. We have one race, the Tennis Horse Houghton Sales Stakes, on the other side of the track. You get 30 runners lined up there. There's prize money down to 12th place.
That's 200,000 quid or something.
Yes, whatever it is, right? But wait a minute. The jockeys don't start pulling up till they see signs for the Dartford Tunnel. Yeah. They are off past the post and over the hill and far away.
The punters say they should race like that all the time, shouldn't they? They should push their horses out
all the way to the line. I know sometimes they don't want to finish too close to a good horse for future handicaps. What about the punters in the shop? They've had their bet that day. They want that horse in the frame that day. And some of these jockeys are pulling up before they've got to the furlong pole. It's a disgrace.
Yeah, no, I do agree with you.
Actually, taking what you said, John, I think there is a difference between jumping in the flat. Quite often, as John says, the horse is knackered, you're knackered, and you're a long way behind the second horse or the third horse, and you do drop your hands. And if something comes and does you for third place, of course, the punters...
I'm not talking about punishing a tired horse. I'm talking about stopping a horse that's obviously full of running. I'm talking about once a winning chance has gone,
a
jockey drops his hands and he coasting in fifth or sixth when it's possible he could have got third or second.
Well, as John said, I agree with John on that. It's quite a rare occasion. Their feet should never touch the ground. They should
But the stewards aren't doing enough. Michael Canane, he's in the news. The rider gave the horse at Royal Ascot. Was he suspended or fined for misuse of the whip when he won the race?
It was Grand Lodge.
Grand Lodge. In the
I mean, it's difficult in as much as, you know, they want them not to hit the horses, but they want them to... be in the frame. But let's have a look at last night, a race here last night, because Willie Carson was in action here last night, and he rode a horse, I think, in the 2 mile race. It was running for the first time, admittedly, over a distance, looked to have the race at his mercy with about a furlong to run, and then to my mind, I thought that he just didn't particularly stop riding, but definitely eased down and allowed Jack Button to come up and catch him right in the shadow of the post. Let's have a look now.
And they come down to the 3 furlong marker, and it's one voice in the lead. The yellow colours on the outside is Honeyman. Further wide, the blue and white striped cap coming with a run is Zaboon. Just over 2 furlongs to go, and one voice ridden along Honeyman. Here comes Zaboon on the outside, travelling well. Come down towards the 2 furlong marker on the right of the leading three. It's Zaboon who comes through to share the lead with one voice. Honeyman back in third place. Down these are well clear of Jack Button, who's starting to pick up just over a furlong to go. And Zaboon clear by 3 lengths as they come past the final furlong marker. And Zaboon in the lead. Here comes Jack Button with a storming run on the outside. They're well clear of one voice. They're inside the final furlong now. And Zaboon is being shaken up, but on the far side, Jack Button is finishing with every stride up towards the line. This is going to be close. Jack Button just takes it from Zaboon. One voice back in third, and behind these came Bottles and Honey Mountain Head Turner.
Well, I've got to be totally honest, having watched that again, and considering the horse was running over 2 miles for the first time, I think he came there running away, eased it, and the horse wasn't actually galloping on at the close of the race. What do you think? I'd almost say he was right there. Got to admit, I will retract that, what I said.
I think the horse went clear. I think possibly Willie Carson thought he'd got it won, and Jack Button's got a target to go at. And then when Willie's realised it, oh, about 100 yards from 50 yards from the line, go, oh, goodness gracious me.
Yeah, I think, just watching it again, I just think he's got there too soon. He's run away, yes. Got there too soon.
And the horse didn't go anywhere. You know.
That's a very good, valid plea of mitigation. He ought to have won the race. But I quite agree with you. With the horse having run over the distance for the first time, you can't blame Willie, really. He just...
Hang on. Richard, one word on that.
Well, no.
What would you have said? You'd have hung him, I suppose.
Well, not hung him, but he should be nicked.
Yeah.
No, Jack Button's not the quickest horse in the world, is it?
No.
And he went past that horse. I think Willie should have won.
I think I agree with you. I think he should be nicked, but I would have just made a plea.
Yeah, I just think the horse probably wants holding up. Matt, early bet in your eager.
Banker, Steamer's come in. The first race is Haydock, number 6, Iron Gent. Hill, 7-4, Ladbrokes, 6-4, that's going. 11-8, 5-4. A lot of you banking on Iron Gent in all your doubles and trebles. Glattison, the 3 o'clock at Haydock, is now a 6-1 chance. 10-1 and 8-1's gone. And in the 4:50, Alanese. Clive Brint says Alanese will run a really big race. So it's Iron Gent, Glattison, and Alanese, they're the three today.
Well, Iron Gent, I've heard a good whisper for Wings Cove in the first at Haydock. Let's just have a look at today's picture puzzle competition. £300 prizes. You don't need me to tell you that what you've got to do is guess the name of the horse that's running this afternoon from that Paul Hardman cartoon. Looks a little bit cold up there, can't actually see, just says the North Pole. There you go. Answers this afternoon. We come on air around 3 o'clock. 4 good races. Thanks to everybody, particularly Richard for his horse box, and join you this afternoon.